Last week we built this little German tank hunter with two gun barrels. Now it's time to paint it in some late war German colors. Things will go fine for the most part, but there will be some bumps in the road. So let's jump right into it, I guess. What's up, you beautiful people? It's Uncle Night Shift again. This video is quite special for me because it's gonna be my first German camouflage in... I don't even remember when I painted my last one. Probably never. Anyway, let's first disassemble the model. I think it's always best to have multiple sub-assemblies so the painting and weathering will be much easier and also the results will be much better as you'll be able to get into tight corners and otherwise hard to reach parts. I find it crucial to wash the model in soapy water to remove any grease residue from my fingers, and also dust and other impurities which would affect the paint job. If your paint is randomly stripping down during the weathering process, this might be the reason. Then I leave it to dry in the kit box, and I always make sure to close the lid to prevent any more dust collecting on the model while it's drying. I usually leave it to dry overnight. When it's fully dry, I attach all parts to some temporary painting handles, so I won't need to touch the model while spraying. Something like this. Before we start spraying though, here's a small trick. This magic bottle makes painting so much easier if you have lots of metal parts on your model. Paints usually don't stick to metal as well as plastic, but this primer, oh boy, this primer suddenly makes it the opposite way. Like, the paint will hold better on metal than on plastic. It's definitely worth getting one if you've experienced paint peeling off your metal gun barrels or photo etch details. All it takes is to brush the primer onto them and let it dry. It's a lacquer-based product, so you can clean your brush with alcohol afterwards. Just make sure to don't brush it on the plastic, because it would create these large blobs or something. But again, these can be removed with alcohol or lacquer thinner. Okay, now it's time to use my favorite oxide red surface primer. Someone once said that if you're gonna paint a model in German yellow, then make sure to prime it with oxide red and the paint will look much better. I don't know why, but it sounds good, so yeah, let's try it out. Even though I washed the model, there are still a few dust particles trapped under the primer. But these are easily removed with a sanding sponge. Now I could mix the German yellow. I decided to try ammo paints and following Miguel's advice, I used their acrylic thinner as well. My mixture consists of 20 drops of the darker tone, 24 drops of the lighter one, and 15 drops of acrylic thinner. Now, I should have used more thinner or a drying retarder or something like that because the airbrushing process was problematic to say the least. I mean, don't get me wrong, everything went smoothly on those smaller parts with flat surfaces. Yeah, that was all fine and good, but the problems began on the hull. This is where things start to go downhill. So, here's the thing. Acrylics are different than lacquer paints, so you can't spray ammo or life color paints the same way as you would Tamiya or Gunze. Acrylics need to be sprayed in multiple thin layers to break the surface tension, which is not a problem with lacquers. But in this case, this created its own problems. And by problems, I mean an orange peel effect. This happens when paint starts drying mid-air before it hits the surface, which I would be able to solve using drying retarder or Vallejo airbrush cleaner, which surprisingly works as an excellent flow improver. But anyway, the point is, I messed up. Next time I'll stick with my favorite Tamiya paints, or I don't know. I'll try giving these another shot, but like I said, with the addition of drying retarder, or I'll thin them with airbrush cleaner instead of the original thinner. Now, if the orange peel is faint, it can be partially saved. So, I decided to cover the entire model with a few light coats of Tamiya satin varnish, and then I blasted the surface with cleaner lacquer thinner to partially dissolve the dried up paint and smoothen it out. Anyway, let's continue with the fun stuff. The green was mixed again using ammo paints, and this time I used 10 drops of Reseda green option 1, 2 drops of the darker German yellow, and 1 drop of tap water. This creates a very good consistency for brush application. Yeah, you heard that right, because I decided to paint the camouflage with a brush. Yeah, it's a slow process and it also requires some level of patience, and I spent all of it while painting, so I hope you won't mind if I speed up the footage up a notch. I'm sure you can imagine it in real time, but anyway, so let's talk about the pros and cons. Pros are, well, if you want to create a camouflage with sharp edges, meaning it doesn't have smooth airbrush paint transitions, then painting with a brush might be a good option. If, for example, you don't want to spend hours masking the model or it's not even possible. For example, if your model is covered in lots of delicate photo edge details, slapping some masking tape or masking putty might create a lot of damage. Another obvious reason is if you don't own an airbrush. In that case, choosing models with hard-edged camouflages might be the best option for you. And don't worry, there were plenty of them. Many crews painted their tanks with brushes, and many were even painting like that in the factory. So those were the pros. And cons? I don't think there are any. That's if you paint the camouflage without visible brush strokes. This means you need to apply the paint in multiple thin layers. What you've seen so far is the initial layer where I laid down the shape of each patch and filled it up. The next layer has to be more diluted. In this case, I added one more drop of water to the mixture. Now it's a lot more fun because you're just filling up each patch and the result starts to look more great than terrible. I actually made a color profile for this model before I even started painting it. I always do this to see how the camouflage will look. Not only that, but you can pretty much dial in the shape of each patch. This is especially handy if you're making up your own camouflages, and it's easier to experiment in your computer than on your model. I use Photoshop for this, and if you'd like to see the process, let me know and I can make a video about it when this series is finished. Anyway, in some cases you'll need 3 to 5 thin layers to create a nice opaque but smooth effect. And don't get confused, the fine texture you might see on the sides is actually armor texture, which I created in the previous video. Just mentioning it because I had a judge once saying my model was poorly painted by a brush, while in reality he was talking about the armor texture, and the model was airbrushed. Or maybe I'm doing something wrong and I've been delusional the whole time. So this is the result I achieved. In some places it's not excellent and I wish I used a more diluted paint. I'll admit, this is not my best work, but I think it's nothing horrible, and as always, weathering can save you from so many mistakes. But I like the pattern, it looks like a salamander, so overall I'm quite happy with it. Anyway, I decided to paint a few details in a different tone of German yellow, as if those parts were replaced at some point or added after the camo was applied. The remaining details like bolt cutters, axe, shovel, exhaust, antenna mount, periscopes or the rubber parts on wheels will be painted later after I'm done with oil paints, washes and chipping effects, because right now they just get in the way. So now I took some clear glossy varnish and sprayed the sides with it. This is the old rule to always gloss before adding decals, and don't get me wrong, it's 100% true. But I've been told multiple times that you don't need to do that if the surface is already smooth and if you have decal setting solutions, which I do, so I decided to make a small test. I used the decals from the kit and, you know, standard procedure. Dip them in water, place on the model, adjust the position, standard stuff. Then I covered them with Mr. Decal Softer so they'll trace the light armor texture. I wasn't sure which tactical numbers should I use, because the blue ones looked pretty nice and colorful, but were too distracting. And white ones, kind of boring, so I decided to go without them. I don't know, I just felt like the numbers didn't work with the intricate camouflage. And it's not uncommon to see German tanks without tactical numbers, so yeah, I think it's okay. So, the test. As I said, I applied the markings on a glossy surface on the sides. This worked as it should, so there's no silvering under them. But at the back, I applied the cross without any varnish, and surprisingly, it worked just as good. I just slightly damaged the paint while moving the decal around with a toothpick, but anyway. Now I just had to seal the entire model with several light coats of satin varnish to protect the paint from weathering. And this is especially important because the enamel thinner can absolutely obliterate ammo paints. And as an added bonus, it gives the model a nice sheen which will contrast nicely with the matte weathering effects. Oh, and I almost forgot about the gun barrels. So I painted these in a medium gray mixed from Tamiya paints. Gun tubes were primed in the gray heat resistant primer and I felt like these would get replaced on a regular basis. So that's why I decided to paint them like a fresh replacement. And their matte finish also contrasts nicely with the rest of the vehicle. So I guess that's it for tonight, my friends. I have a feeling that the next episode will be the most crucial in this series because the way the model looks right now, you can hardly tell its shape. So it will come down to oil paints and washes to make it look more appealing and easier to read. That sounds odd, but I hope I'm getting my point across. If I do, smash that like button, and if I don't, smash that like button anyway. Also, let me know your thoughts on this model. Also, I wish you all Happy New Year and a great weekend. A big shout out to my patrons who already know how this model looks after oil paints and washes. Probably even after chipping and rust stones. So if you'd like to get tons of behind the scenes and more information that just didn't make it into this video, then consider checking it out as well. And yeah. Thank you all for watching, I'll see you mates in the next one, and here are some bloopers. I think it's always best to have multiple When it's fully dry, I attach all parts to some temporary painting handles, so I won't need to touch the model whilst... When it's fully dry, I attach... It's a lacquer-based product, so you can clean your brush with Even though I washed the model thoroughly... Anyway, in some cases, you'll need 3 to 5 thin... Also, I...